Hi, I'm Jared Potter, and today we're going to be talking about designing for Windows Phone 101. The section that we're talking about today is Windows Design Language, and you may have commonly heard this known as Metro. It is now Windows Design Language, and we will be talking about a couple different pieces of it. We'll be talking about the influence and inspiration that brought around the design language, and then a couple of the design principles that we measured every single screen against when creating Windows Phone 8. Our first step in building Metro was not to look at other phones or other computers or other pieces of software out there. We basically stepped back and we like to look at how users navigate information in their everyday activities. Our team had the inspiration of transportation graphics. Whether it's at Narita or JFK, these graphics are basically used to get someone from point A to point B in a cross-cultural, cross-language, quick and direct type of way. They should be able to look at these from any point in the airport and see where they're going, where they're from, and where they're going to. We actually went out and took a lot of pictures of this, and you'll notice the iconography and simple, consistent typography across all these. Another piece that we looked at is some old art. Earlier in the presentation, I used Mosimo Vignelli and a quote from him. This is actually the Manhattan subway map that he designed and is a rather famous piece. But the goals, if you think about it, for a subway map are very similar to the goals of a phone. When you get in the subway and you get in and the doors close, you hope that when they close, you end up in the right destination. The same with on our phone. When you press a tile, you hope that you end up in the right application or where you are trying to go. Also, we started using really consistent systems that have been around since the beginning of time, just very fundamentals in graphic design and visual design. We went back to the grid and really invested in a lot of time in the grid structure that would show on every single screen. And the grid has been around since handwritten books and really one of the very first things that you learn when you go to design school. It was used and broken with geometric designs that you would see in the Bauhaus movement. These are really timeless and ways to create order that comes across to the user like simplicity. Another thing that we used a lot of, and some of the things that are actually pretty cool right now, especially in the digital age that we're in, is infographics. And infographics are all over the place, all around us. If you watch the Olympics, you would see some very important infographics kind of all over the walls, and they used them in their design, as well as modern branding systems. A lot of these modern branding systems have only come out in the last couple of years, but really are using a timeless typographic style, as well as some of these older brands, like the American Airlines one, is the only major airline that hasn't changed its branding or style in the last 50 years. The other place that we looked to before we started working on actual physical screens was to look inwardly and see what Microsoft is doing. One of the other goals with Windows Design Language was to help the movement that was happening across Microsoft to unify our products. So there was programmers out there unifying our code base so that we would have the same code on phones and tablets and on PCs. But we were doing the work that hopefully would unify us in a visual way so that the consumers would look at the products and say, this is one consistent company. One of the things we looked at was some of the cool design work that was coming out of Office, and this was their visions of the future and how you would interact with it. Media Center, you'll see that the content was beginning to bubble up to the top, and it was about typography. They used motion graphics, and this was one of the first teams at Microsoft that they actually had a full-time motion designer designing these graphics. The content bubbled up, and less you stopped seeing as much chrome that was surrounding the content. It would just be about the content itself. Another product that made me fall in love with Microsoft design for the very first time was the Zune product. As a matter of fact, Jeff Fong, the creative director on Media Center, or who worked as a designer on Media Center and Zune, was the creative director on Windows Phone 8. And Zune HD won a couple of IDEA awards and was also a really beautiful physical hardware project that came out of Microsoft. Of course, we have Xbox, and you notice the content coming forward front and center, the bold use of tiles and color. And then, of course, we had the current existing state of mobile at Microsoft, which was Windows Mobile 6. And Windows Mobile 6 was kind of a fractured product. There were numerous manufacturers, carriers, resolutions, and languages that it supported. And we saw how owners were starting to use their phone, not only the Windows mobile phones at Microsoft, but other phones, either for the good or also in a lot of ways for the bad, and their interactions in a day-to-day with the world around them. So Microsoft looked at all these phones that were outside of Microsoft and they saw the way that all of them were helping and also beginning to hinder in similar ways, and they decided that they wanted to come up with a new kind of phone. So the inspiration, and this was inspiration both internally to Microsoft and inspiration outside of Microsoft, inspiration that came from histories of graphic design as well as things that had just been created in the last couple years, was if you're not going to match pixels from the templates when you're designing on the phone as a product, spend more time with the inspiration than just with the specs. It's very easy to pull up in a spec document and just sort of measure out pixels and do that. But if you're trying to create a product that's uniquely yours, that has your brand and style, spend a lot of time with the inspiration. Use a creative brief, or at minimum, create some mood boards. You saw those earlier on when I had kind of the wayfinding graphics all spread out across the screen. Create some of your own. Go out and take pictures. Put all the different pieces together. Create color swatches. It'll be worth your time. And then spend time consuming before you spend time creating. Now, I am a creator. I'm very passionate about creation. I helped create the phone. I created a family. I'm a teacher that helps people create, and I created a company recently. But at the same time, I always give creators this advice. There's always somebody out there that you can learn from. If you're gonna work on a great mobile app, look at some of the inspiration that's out there in the world around you. One of the things that quotes that I love is from Jim Jarmusch. He's a director that created the movie Coffee and Cigarettes. He says this, "Nothing is original, steal from anywhere that resonates with inspiration or fuels your imagination. Devour old films, new films, music, books, paintings, photographs, poems, dreams, random conversations, architecture, bridges, street signs, trees, clouds, bodies of water, light and shadows. Select only things to steal from that speak directly to your soul. If you do this, your work and theft will be authentic. Authenticity is invaluable, and this is the part I love. Originality is non-existent. And don't bother concealing your thievery. Celebrate it if you feel like it. In any case, always remember what Jean-Luc Godard said, it's not where you take things from, it's where you take them to. In the next section, I'm going to talk a little bit about the design principles. So I said in the last thing, influence and inspiration, creating in a vacuum isn't good, right? But neither is creating without boundaries. A lot of times the best design comes with limitations, and any medium has its limitations. These design principles that we created in the design studio became pillars or high bars that we'd hold every single screen up against. They're very important in any application to make sure that you're measuring the quality of your application. We said this at first, Windows Phone design philosophy is exemplified by clean, uncluttered apps, screens that operate quickly, minimize typing, and surface new information automatically. Interactions happen directly with content, and visual elements have great fit and finish. You have the opportunity to use the phone for what it's best suited for, apps for the mobile lifestyle. The principles in this section will help you realize your unique contributions to the Windows Phone platform. The five I'll be talking about today is pride in craftsmanship, more with less, fast and fluid, and authentically digital, win is won. Pride in craftsmanship. Devote time and energy to small things that many will see often. Engineer the experience to be complete and polished at every stage. This is one thing I can't pound home enough. If your application is a hit, or if your OS is a hit, people will be seeing it over and over and over throughout the day. If you designed the start screen for Windows Phone, millions of users will be using it on a daily basis. Or if you designed a little app that takes photos and adds them up to the cloud, you might get a large market base and people will be using it over and over. The small frustrations in it will become big frustrations to them. Think about every single detail of the phone. One of the quotes that I love about Windows Phone says this, "It feels alive, everything bounces, everything swoops, everything flips, every single action is lushly animated." And of course, my favorite part, it doesn't just sweat the details, blood was spilt. I love all the little details about Windows Phone, but the thing that makes me proud about this quote is that Gizmodo actually saw it when they were writing a review on the device. They said they took time to dedicate it to the details. Here's a couple of craftsmanship how-to. One, I mentioned the grid earlier in a design presentation. Get on the grid. The grid is the glue that gives your content the cohesion it needs. So it lays it out, and it is by far the easiest way to create order, which feels like simplicity to the user. Another one is use hierarchy and balance when designing your apps. Good use of typography can create a sense of structure and rhythm in your app's interface. Here's an example of good hierarchy and balance. Here's an example of bad hierarchy. Everything's completely left aligned. The page doesn't feel evenly weighted. And there's a nice simple rule when you're approaching hierarchy. Use a rule of thirds. You'll hear this a lot in design, but basically splitting up your content into three different sections so that the human eye can absorb it really easily. Any more than that, it becomes confusing to the user. Another thing that I'd like to mention about craftsmanship when you're designing your own apps, don't forget who you are. Find the typography that best reflects your app's personality. Here's a couple of great examples of this. The New York Times, right? This is beautiful. This is their typography. It feels very much like their brand, but it still feels like a part of the Windows Phone application. The next thing I'd like to talk about is less, more with less. Create a clean and purposeful experience by leaving only the most relevant elements on screen. When it comes to designing great apps and experiences, we believe in content, not Chrome. Focusing on the content and not the Chrome elements allows your app content to shine. So one of the things that it's very easy to do when creating an application is do a lot of adorning elements, and that's what we refer to as Chrome. It's a simple way as a designer, especially most of the applications out there are driven by content now. If you don't have the content yet and you're just sitting in Photoshop, it's sometimes hard to just say, this is what it will look like with content. And so what you end up doing is making a lot of adorning elements. If you actually take the content over the Chrome, by removing that Chrome and taking advantage of the font and the scale and the color, it will be much more legible and easy to read from the user. And then the last thing is, let your content breathe. This is called white space in the design world, and this is just putting basically space around your most important content. Relevant content commands and functionality are apparent and easy to interact with. A lot of times, as designers or app creators, it's very difficult to remove features to create that space around important elements. The one thing that I'd like to say about white space is the ultimate wasted space is not white space, but over-cluttered space where everything just feels of equal importance. And that's never true in a good application. Fast and fluid. Products that feel immersive and responsive are compelling, delightful, and bring the interface to life. Let people interact directly with content and respond to actions quickly with matching energy. Bring life to the experience, create a sense of continuity, and tell a story through meaningful use of motion. Be alive. So this is my fluid how-to. Live tiles are responsive, alive, and engaging. One of the cues that we took in the design studio was from broadcast graphics, seeing how it constantly felt relevant and up-to-date, and you never really felt bored with the content. But it wasn't just animating for animating's sake. It was actually showing you new things when new things were relevant to show on the screen. Don't just animate for the purpose of animation. This is going back to the original thing I was talking about. It might be one of those things that becomes frustrating if it just plays over and over again. Fluid how-to, just motion. Help people learn how your app's interface works. One of the things that we learned in the design studio is that you can use motion to give a hint to the users that there are actual different functions on different items. One of the motions that you see commonly on Windows Phone is something called turnstile feather, where you see all the items animate in differently on a list at different times. It basically shows to the user that these are all individual hit targets and they can hit them all separately and get different results from the list. Authentically digital. It sounds a little bit corny to say something is authentically digital, but this is something that Microsoft very much believes in. It's basically saying it's all about not being what we're not, which basically means if we are a calendar app, we don't need to look like a physical calendar in the real world. We need to get you the data that's most relevant to you at the time, right? And a couple rules for digital how-to. Use iconographics or infographics. Iconographics are kind of this old style icons, which if you look at, they do make sense and you can figure out what they're doing. Like here's a calculator, but you can look just as easily at this camera and see in a simple version of the camera what it applies to. It also applies to a lot broader range of cameras, because if you were to use an actual physical picture of a camera, the user may assume that that only applies to cameras that look like that or are similar to that. Win is one. Using a common UI model and ecosystem creates complete end-to-end user scenarios. In other words, try not to reinvent the wheel. Innovation is great, but not at the expense of the user experience. Windows isn't just a phone. Not only does it have Xbox, Office, Bing, Outlook, SkyDrive, and pieces of Windows on the mobile phone, but all these platforms are available for some form of development and creation across. So think platform when you're creating a Windows phone app. Consider how your app will work across these factors and users and scenarios, and the fact that you could have this application not only in the palm of your hand, but in a tablet or on a laptop on your lap, or maybe even on your media center or Xbox screen in your living room. And that wraps up sort of the design principles that I was talking about. Pride and craftsmanship, more with less, fast and fluid UI, authentically digital, and win as one.